Sometimes we don't see how they could. Struggles that break our hearts in two sometimes blind us to the truth. Our Father knows what's best for us. His ways are not our own. So when your pathway grows dim and you just don't see Him, remember you're never alone. God is too wise to be mistaken. Too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see His plan, when you can't trace His hand, trust His heart. When you don't understand.
the Wordmaster Presents, a podcast presenting Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life. And now, to the studio and the Wordmaster.
Welcome, indeed, to our series and the series finale, actually, of Rise Above It. This has been a very, very eye-opening, enlightening series. I don't know for you, but for me, it has truly been a blessing. Today, as we conclude, we're looking at the topic of uncertainty. In fact, in one of our scriptures, we'll see how important the knowledge of this experience is. And by this experience, I mean that we should not be uncertain. So we need to rise above uncertainty. As you listen today, I just want to encourage you, as always, to check the description area. However, today is a very special one because I've included a document written by my pastor, Pastor Ken Richards, which I've been avoiding sharing for the longest, but today I'm spreading it like wildfire all over my social media because today is Certainty Day, and I want people to be sure of. And there's four there, but there's so much more in the reading. So while you're listening, please take the opportunity to go there and look for it. It should be early on in the description, the four great certainties. I promise you, it will be a blessing to you. So we have come from Isaiah chapter 40, verse 31, which says, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." Today's scripture reading comes from Matthew 6, 31 to 34. The Bible says, "Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof." And two more verses, Luke 21, 25 and 26. "And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars and upon the earth, distress of nations with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are common on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken." Let us pray. Father in heaven, thank you so much for allowing us the opportunity to once again come into your amazing presence. And as we reflect on these things, Father, as we touch on these things, as we look to these things, we ask you for your divine heart, your divine guidance, your divine assurance on these matters. Lord, teach us from your holy book the importance of the understanding to which we are seeking today. Lord, I pray a very special blessing upon those who are not believers who will be listening to the message today, because these series are designed for them, Lord God, more importantly. And I pray that you will bless their heart, O Father, some person listening with the understanding that you want to bless them immensely, you want to bless them abundantly with certainty. And so today, Lord God, we come with the assurance, knowing full well that you who have promised are well able to deliver. Be with us now, Heavenly Father, as we seek to engage our minds throughout this hour, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So at this time, we're going to step away for a couple items of special music. First, we're going to have "I Know Whom I've Believed." "I Know Who Holds Tomorrow," that is. "I Know Who Holds Tomorrow." And then our theme song, "Still I Rise."
From day to day, I don't Sky. please take a few seconds to support the channel. See the info in the description.
There's this famous poem by the poet Robert Frost. In it, he talks about coming to a fork in the road. And on, I think, well, he doesn't specify, I don't remember, but on one side is this well-traveled path. And you could tell it's well-traveled because it's a manicured pathway. It's clean, no debris, no leaves, no nothing to let you know that people travel there all the time. And on the other side, that divergent path, as he talks about, is the one that's obviously less traveled. It's all the breeze and tree branches and the whatnots that tells you. It's a telltale that this is the less traveled path. And guess which path the author of the poem took, which of course would make sense because it's entitled The Road Less Traveled. And of course, it ends with a beautiful thought. When you get a chance, go back and reread it. Again, Robert Frost, The Road Less Traveled. I think that's called The Road Less Traveled. Today, as we conclude our series, Rise Above It, we're looking at uncertainty. So we began the series by looking at fear. Fear kills, doubt kills, uncertainty kills. And so these three killers, and they are not silent killers, my friends, they are not silent killers in the least. They are very loud, very loud. And persons will know, persons can tell that you have fear, that you have doubt, and that you have uncertainty. And you yourself will know. This is not one of those silent things like an aneurysm that creeps upon you. You exhibit it and you manifest it. And persons can tell you don't really claim to believe what you say you believe when you exhibit these things. In our scripture reading, we are told that we ought not concern ourselves about, look, here we go, the practicalities of life say, oh, you got to do this and you got to do that because. But notice what Jesus says, therefore, take no thought saying, what shall I eat? I'm going to make it personal. Or what shall I drink? Or how shall I be clothed? Goes on to say, for after all these things do the Gentiles seek. And again, there's nothing intrinsically wrong about having something to eat, drink, wear. Right? Obviously, because we are in this human body, we desire these things. However, notice what he says. After all these things do the Gentiles, the heathens, the pagans, unbelievers seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you have need of all these things. It's inobvious. Again, if it's obvious to you, obviously it's obvious to him. Make sense? I would hope so. But persons inordinately go after these things, and by these things, it's an overabundance here because the necessity dictates that you have enough to eat, enough to drink, and place to stay, and so forth. And you're content. And you're content. We looked at statements yesterday from the Apostle Paul talking about how he lived in contentment. And today, as we read, I want you to understand. As we study, I want you to contemplate the thought that fear, doubt, and uncertainty are not to be hallmarks of your life. And again, as I did yesterday, I made sure to send this out to persons I know who may not necessarily walk the straight and narrow path, the path that's taken, who might not consider themselves believers. But again, this series is an evangelistic series, the weekend series here on The Word Master Presents. And if this is your first time listening, I invite you to go to the description area to check out the booklet that's our offer for today, The Four Great Certainties, and I promise you, you will not regret it. You will not regret it. But yeah, the majority on this planet, that's the crippling influence of our age, uncertainty. We all want to know what's coming down the pipe. And not just because we want to know for no one's sake, because some of us say we want to be ready, we want to meet it. And so, we worry about tomorrow. For those of you who missed that song, we're going to replay it again. towards the end. I don't know about tomorrow, but I know who holds my hands. And I know that there are many of you listening right now who are going through the anxiety of what may come. Talk about high prices, food, gasoline, health, education, and so on. We see wars cropping up all over the place, and you wonder, when is it going to come to my shore? You see the political maneuverings, and you wonder, who's going to sit in the hot seat come day after election? And you're wondering, how is it going to affect you and your family? Uncertainty, uncertainty, uncertainty. But it is Gentile thinking, and understand that term, my beloved. If you are a person who declares that you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, it is Gentile thinking to worry about the things that your Father knows that you need of. And the Bible says that He will give unto you anyway. Isn't that what we're coming up to? You know it, right? But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, shall be given unto you, shall be declared, it's yours, because you have made God your first, your last, your best. My beloved, understand that when we dedicate our lives to the Lord, these things are ours. Voices may whisper into your ears, you may want more, you may need more, you may require more. But don't listen to those voices, because the Bible tells us that God is all we need. If we have Him in our life, there is our contentment. There is our contentment. But He loves us so much that He adds things to us just because we are content with Him. I am satisfied with Jesus. Are you satisfied with Jesus today? Or is your ambitious pride so off the charts that you have quite a good nest egg in the bank, but you're still going after more? You hit retirement age, and yet you're still not going after work and things like that because you have to in these economic times, because like I said, you're well off, but you just need more. You just need to be certain that the little that you have there that could tide you over for the rest of your life is really enough. Seek first, beloved. And it doesn't mean that after you seek first, then you can seek the others, because there is no room in the heart for seeking after the Lord and seeking after the world. It just doesn't make sense, and it just would add to your uncertainty about the things you have. Some persons have so much, I tell you, that they worry about that. Will I have it in the morning? A friend of mine, we were talking about that just the other day, how people operate. But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Verse 34 is a key verse. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow. And again, this needs to be qualified. Of course, in certain contexts, tomorrow needs to be thought about. It's talking about anxiety of the thoughts of tomorrow. Again, the negative thinking, this is the focus of the verses, so don't get it out of context. There's certain things that we have to plan. In fact, He Himself tells us that if you're about to build something, you have to plan it out, or else you're going to get things wrong, and you're going to have to build again, and people are going to laugh at you. Right? So He Himself understands the principles. He's not saying about not making plans. He's talking about not taking on to yourself unnecessary worries about tomorrow. That building that you're talking about building, are people going to live in it? Are people going to come to it if it's a store? And so on. That's what it means. Take therefore no anxious, so we can insert the word anxious. Take therefore no anxious thought for the things of tomorrow. For the things of tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Isn't that always the case? One of the songs that we heard says, trust His heart. Trust His heart. And believe me, my friends, we need to trust God more. More than we say we do. I had a frank and honest conversation with my church group last night in our podcast. You probably can get access to it if you go to the main podcast site, and that's by clicking on the description area where it says From the Heart in the speaker platform, From the Heart, and you can see the list of podcasts available. And we were looking at covetousness on that podcast, looking at prosperity versus poverty, and we see even more there about being content with what you have, being content with such things as you have. Because, again, how does that verse end? Because the Lord says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Interestingly enough, that's where we're headed next. Because, of course, the Bible says, right? John 14, 1-3, Jesus addressing that issue. We live in uncertain times, but we have a certain Savior. He says, let not your heart be troubled. And that's what we're dealing with today, the troubling of the heart, the anxiety of the heart, the palpitations of the heart that lead you to the emergency room. Yes, like I said, fear kills, doubt kills, and uncertainty, I do believe, is the mass killer among them three. And you want to be sure, you want to be certain, have a right foundation in your understanding of who you believe your Lord and Savior to be. If it's yourself, can I be honest and frank with you? You're in trouble. You're in serious trouble. But if you rely, and I don't like to call him a higher power, because he is the highest power in the universe. If you rely on him, if you trust in him, then I promise you, again, you're not going to know about certain things and many things about tomorrow, but you're going to know who holds that tomorrow, and you're going to know that he holds your hands. Jesus says, I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will surely come again. He says, if it were not so, I would have told you. I don't want you to live in a spirit of uncertainty. I want you to live in a spirit of knowing. Knowing that I'm going away, but I'm coming back. I'm coming back. Beloved, it was almost, we are shy of 9 years from when he said those words to his disciples. AD 31. We're coming up on 2031 in a little bit. Almost 2,000 years since he said those words. But it has not diminished over the years, and he has not forgot his promises. And I tell you, I believe that we're not going to hit AD 31 before he returns. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. My beloved, that to me is certainty. That to me is the assurance that we really need. So Romans 8:31, as to that, what shall we then say to these things? And the answer is, if God be for us, who or what, I say, can be against us? Who or what can be against us? We can be certain. We can be certain when the skies above us turn from light gray to pitch black. We can be certain when the ground beneath us starts to rumble a little, and then a lot, and then a great lot, and buildings not just start to sway, but to turn to dust. We can be certain when threats of nuclear winter threaten to annihilate the planet and climate change to take us into oblivion. We can be certain when the news hits from the doctor, you have terminal cancer and only weeks to live. We can be certain when friends forsake us, when family disown us. We can be certain when all hell breaks loose. We can be certain. You can be certain on today, and I promise you, my beloved friend, that if your trust is in the Lord and you turn away from trust in self, you can and you will be certain on today that there is a God in heaven who loves you more than you even can consider loving your own self. You can be certain on today, for I know whom I have believed, 2 Timothy 1:12, and I'm persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Are you certain, my friends? Are you for sure believing that the God of the universe cares about you? Or like some, do you believe that he just created you and went on his merry way? No, not so. Yes, like my friend again was talking about to me the other day, does Jesus care when Russia bombs the Ukraine and little children's arms get exploded off? Does Jesus care when families have to separate because of the ravages of war? Does Jesus care? Does Jesus hear when husbands who pledged and vowed to love their wives even unto death are the very cause of the death of those wives? Does Jesus care when children are abused, misused, when their very foundation are shaken because those who swore to love them no longer do and turn on them? Does Jesus hear? And does Jesus care when this planet of ours is ravaged by hunger, by homelessness, by financial hardships? Oh, yes, he does. I know, not I believe, I know he does. And in fact, right now, my beloved, because he is still invested in our humanity, I could just imagine tears falling when the planet, the world that he created in love, turns on its own. But there's coming a day of reckoning, my friends, a day that is certain, that you can believe in, then all these things will be over and done with. But you know who will not survive that day? The fearful and the unbelieving. I've been saying that for the longest. The book of Revelation tells us that the top two lists of people who will end up in hellfire, as it were, are the fearful and the unbelieving. The two persons that we talked about in our series. Those who have no faith and those who are living in doubt. And today we see their certain future. My beloved, it doesn't have to be you. I promise you, on the authority of God's word, that what I'm saying to you is true. That one day very soon, that the God of heaven is going to say, it is done. And he's going to put in his appearance to come and claim his people for his own. Friend of mine, as I wind down, I want to appeal especially to those of you who are not certain. You look into your bank account and you're able only to make ends meet. But my beloved, I want you to contemplate something as we go forward. Maybe it's about time that you deny yourself certain things. Who needs to binge watch a whole bunch of Hulu and Disney Plus? You need to take some of that money that you're investing in these things and invest them in worthwhile causes. You complain that there are people hungering in Africa while these churches are taking money. Why don't you take some of that money that you're hoarding up for a quote-unquote a rainy day? It's not going to rain, I promise you. It's not going to rain. The Lord said so. It's not going to rain. Take some of that money and invest it in Africa or wherever there's homelessness or poverty. Do something good with it while you still can. There's so much that we're wasting, and yet we're complaining because we have bills to pay. Yet we cause our own misery. We cause our own uncertainty because we accumulate so much. We stockpile so much, things that we don't really need. Sufficient to the day, the word of God says, is the evil thereof. Luke 21, 25 to 28, as we close. And there shall be signs in the sun and in the moon and in the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations with perplexities, the sea and the waves roaring. In the times to which we've come, it's going to be characterized by uncertainty, because persons are going to be looking around, seeing the signs of the times, and have no clue what is going on. But I say to you, on the authority of God's word, that you can know what is going on, because the word of God tells you. The only reason that there are people living in perplexity is because they don't know about the future. They don't know what God says in his word. They don't know that God has promised to see us through. And so while people are running around trying to scare you that the world is going to end in climate change if we don't clean up our act and if man doesn't stop doing this and doing that, that's not what God says. That's not what God says. In fact, the word of God is clear on the fact that destruction is going to come to those who are polluting and causing nuclear wars and all these things. Destruction is going to come to them. But this world will outlast them all. In fact, it will be the habitation of God's people for all eternity. God himself will be an inhabitant of earth. The book of Revelation tells us, brethren, do not be deceived. This earth shall last. The Bible says the meek shall inherit the earth. It's not going anywhere. But you and I will if we reject God's offer of salvation at this time. He goes on to say, men's hearts filling them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth, for the powers of heaven shall be shaken. You see, beloved, when things start to shake, if you are not firmly planted on a sure foundation, you will fall, and you will fall to ashes, my friends. You will fall to ashes, not just fall. 27 and 28, And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. And when these things begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, my friend, for your redemption draweth nigh. My beloved, my friends out there who do not know Jesus as a personal Savior, there's still time. There is still time. Right now, Jesus is pleading his blood, his precious blood, on your behalf. And even though it may seem crowded around you, even though it may seem crowded around you, my friends, there's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you still. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. There's room at the cross for you, even still.
The cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide, and its grace so free is sufficient for me, and deep is its fountain, as wide as the sea. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. Though millions have found him a friend and have turned from the sins they have sinned, the Savior still waits to open the gates and welcome a sinner before it's too late.
There's room. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one. Yes, there's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross.
Yes, my friends, there is indeed still room at the cross for you. Will you come? Will you come? Beloved, I wish all of you listening could get on a hot air balloon, an airplane, a helicopter, or whatever, and have a bird's eye view of your fear, of your doubt, of your uncertainty, and you will see how it all pales in comparison from the distance you're at. That's where you need to be, even right here on the ground. That's where you need to be, rising high above these circumstances of fear and doubt and uncertainty. If today was your first time listening, I encourage you to go back to the other 2 days of the series and see what you've missed and get caught up. My beloved, as we close out, those of you who do not know the Lord, and you never even thought about knowing the Lord, probably not even on today, and you heard this message, someone shared this with you, and it has made all the difference in the world, knowing that you can be certain, knowing that uncertainty does not have to be part of who you are. I invite you to make the first steps in a new direction, to do a turnaround, and to have yourself a life insurance policy that puts all of these ones on earth to shame. And that life is a life which measures with the life of God. There's still room for one more. Will you come? Will you come before it is too late? I urge you on the authority of God's word that it would be the best decision you make of your life. Again, in the description area, free for the first time on this podcast and any of my other podcasts is a little booklet entitled The Four Great Certainties. It was put together by my pastor, Pastor Ken Richards, and this is something that he really, really wants to share with the world, and I hope you take advantage of this. The Four Great Certainties is right there in the description, very early on the list of things here. And while you're there, I want you to check out the video and the transcript that talks about Rise Above the Storm to help you to be fortified against the things that are coming on the earth, things that we've talked about in this series. And go ahead and subscribe to the RMG Productions YouTube channel and look at the link to find out how you can support this ministry. This series and all the others that are brought to you because of love. But I need your prayers, most importantly, above everything else, and your financial support so we can produce more programs like this to send to the ends of the earth. And I appeal to you that if the Lord places upon your heart today, there's a link that would offer you such an opportunity to partner with us as we share a message of hope to the ends of the earth in uncertain times. But now we've come to the most important part of our series, part where we petition the throne of grace on our behalf as we seek the Lord in prayer. And today, you may not have prayed like this ever in your life, or it's been a while, but I want you, either way you are, to bow your head, and if you can, to bow the knee, and let's go before the throne of mercy and grace in true repentance, in true heart sincerity, seeking for certainty in our uncertain lives. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, first of all, I come as your representative, thankful for the opportunity to stand in the gap for all those who are praying at this time. Lord, your word tells us, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from all their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, forgive their sins, and heal their land. You said in your word that if I stand in the gap and make up the hedge on the behalf of others, destruction will be averted, and the things that you have said will come upon the land will not come. And so, Father, I stand, Lord, before you as your representative, standing between the living and the dead, standing here, Lord God, on the behalf of those who want to be certain about tomorrow, who want to be sure that they are going to wake up tomorrow in a world where even though the ground beneath them rumbles and the sky above them falls, that they can stand certain that the God of heaven, who made promises some 2,000 years ago, is well able to fulfill that. And when all else fails, that they will be left standing because the Lord of heaven has promised them thus. O Lord God, your word assures us that the righteous will never be forsaken or his seed begging bread. And we claim these promises on today. We are certain, Father, and I pray for those who are not. I pray for those who are worrying. I pray for those who will still worry even after hearing these words of life. Father, it is a prayer of my heart that you will please, please do something out of the common, out of the ordinary, and just manifest yourself to such a one. And they may be in deep doubt and deep denial because they are living in deep fear and deep confusion. But Lord, if there's anyone who could do something for the ones who can't do nothing for themselves, it is you. And I trust you, Lord. And I believe you, Lord. And I know you, Lord. And I know you will make yourself available to those who want to know more. Lord, your word is clear on that matter. And so I just want to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for your righteousness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy and your grace. And thank you for taking the time out to lend an ear and listen to the words of my heart. And now, Father, I commit not just the ones who do not know you, but all of us into your care and into your keeping. Father God, I pray that on this October day, Lord, that many persons will make a day of new beginnings, will recommit their lives to you, will repurpose their intentions for you, Lord God, and that there will be new creatures in your sight going forward, first steps in a new direction, knowing that we don't have long in this world. Father, I pray for those who have questioned this thing about you, Lord Jesus, and God in heaven, and these things, I pray, Father, that you will please work upon your hearts, Lord. Please reveal yourself to them in a whole new way. Father, I pray that you will allow them opportunity and time, Lord, to investigate whether these things are so, and not just take others' words for it, and not just live any type of lives, because according to them, you only live once. And their certainty is what they can make from their jobs and the money that they have and the cars that they own and all their possessions. Father, I pray today that someone makes their certainty in you. Thank you for being a prayer hearing, prayer answering God on this day. We love you, praise you, and we give you all the praise, honor, and glory that you so richly deserve, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. My friends, as I say goodbye to you on this day, we're going to leave you with a couple of songs as we close out. And I want my voice to be the last thing you hear on this program as we close out the series. I want the Lord to speak to you, to minister to you in these songs, and just so that you can know that not because I, the Word Master, says you can trust him, but I want to present him to you, the ultimate Word Master, who speaks words of comfort into your troubled, uncertain heart. Yes, you can trust me. You have been listening for these past 3 days to this weekend series, Lifted, Rise Above. And I promise you, my friends, that if you rise above your fear, your doubt, and your uncertainty, there will be someone you'll meet in the ear who will promise and has promised to take you through and past all of this. May God bless you abundantly until next weekend by His grace.
Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word. Just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove You more and more. Jesus, Jesus, pray. For grace to trust Him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust Him. Precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that He is with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved You more and more. Jesus, Jesus, pray. For grace to trust Him more. Jesus, how I trust Him, how I've proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him. Trust Him more.
just live from day to day. I don't borrow from its sunshine, for its skies may turn to gray. I don't
Presents. Please join us next time.